Well, hello everyone and welcome back to the channel. I'm Richard and this is Lap of the World, your home for road trips and racetracks. Now, I have paused in the midst of preparation for my next outing to make this video. That outing will be at Dakota County Technical College on August 28th for a Track Night in America event. But I have paused those preparations, as I said, to answer a question that came up recently on one of the NSX Facebook groups that I'm a member of. And that question was, hey, I would like to take my first generation NSX on a cross-country road trip. What should I pack with me? Now, I'm not going to cover everything I put in the car to go on a trip for my own part, because a lot of that is not really, I don't think, material to the actual question they were asking, but rather is going to be very individual, like your personal effects and stuff like that. I've done that kind of at a high level prior to, I think, NS Expo 2017, question mark? Anyway, I've done that before at kind of a high level. I may remake that in the future. But for today, we're going to be talking specifically about the mechanical or technical kit that I take with me, which I have kind of arrayed on the table behind me here, to ensure that I can do my road trip, of course, in my case, at the end of which I expect to drive around a racetrack a bunch, and then still have some expectation of the car making it home. So that's what we're going to cover today, is the technical accoutrements, spares, tools, etc. that I take with me, as well as some of the philosophy behind it. Now, even if the tool selection in detail doesn't apply to cars outside of the NSX, I think the minimalist, if you will, packing philosophy is probably going to be applicable to almost any car or certainly any kind of classic car that you're going to take on a road trip. So, might be worth sticking around yet. But without any further ado, let's jump right into it.
The overarching philosophy here is to take just enough to deal with what one would expect to be the most common inconveniences, both generally and car-specific. Any tools that don't add some real ability are left out, down to specific wrench and socket sizes. By taking as little as possible and packaging it in a clever way, you maximize your ability to deal with issues while minimizing the footprint of tools and such when it comes to packing for your trip, leaving room for more personal effects and/or souvenirs from your journey. That said, I'm packing with track days in mind, and the NSX is a very reliable car, so grain of salt with even this level of preparation.
So we are going to move from right to left with respect to what I have laid out on the table here. So on the right, we have general spares, fluids, and a jack stand. We have kind of our, what I would call our general roadside bag. We have a toolbox, and then we have my sort of electronics kit over here with a torque wrench in the front. One thing I don't have on the table right now, of course, is my jack. Now, me going and doing track days, I bring with me a full-size aluminum racing jack. So it's reasonably lightweight, or light enough weight to carry in the trunk without too much concern, but it's a little more substantial and safe, in my opinion, than any kind of scissor jack that comes with your toolkit. Now, if you are only going cross-country and not doing anything enthusiastic on one end or the other, you could probably get away with taking just a scissor jack, although I would highly encourage a quality jack stand to go along with it, just to save yourself a repair bill or potentially an appendage in certain circumstances. So, but with that said, I'm gonna clear the table, except for this rightmost pile over here, and we'll get stuck into that. And I'm gonna move pretty quickly, so don't feel bad about pausing and rewinding if you want a further explanation or need the list of stuff. I'll try and kind of list things where lists are necessary on the screen for visual reference too. All right, so getting into the odds and ends here, we're gonna move from left to right this time. We have, in my case, this is kind of particular to me. I've had a lot of trouble with one rear wheel bearing in particular. So I made myself a spare wheel bearing and hub assembly, already with the extended studs pressed in, is what I have on the rest of the car. And then a spare axle nut. So again, I haven't had to use this at all. I think I've actually solved the problem, and I think the hub that's in here actually being not true. I think this hub is bent somehow. I think that was my problem the whole time. But I already have this made up, so I take it with me, better safe than sorry. Moving to the right then, we have spare fluids. At a bare minimum, I would recommend taking spare oil and some spare brake fluid. brake fluid, you might think, well, I don't do track days. I'm not really going to use brake fluid per se. But, you know, let's say you did have a leak and you're able to fix the leak. Now you have something to top it off with. Or in my case, is actually, you know, case in point, coming back from my last track event at Waterford Hills, my clutch slave cylinder sprung a slow leak. And I was able, because I carried an extra bottle of brake fluid with me, it's probably overkill being RBF 600, but I was able to top off the clutch master and keep fluid in the system and actually limp all the way home to then, you know, be able to take care of it on my own time instead of having to pay a shop bill or deal with, you know, towing or anything of that matter. So, bare minimum oil and brake fluid, occasionally in some other vehicles, I've carried a jug of distilled water because A, you can drink it, and B, you can top up your coolant system if you had an issue there. Finally, on the far right, we have a jack stand. Now, this is a kind of an aluminum post and base style, and I'll give credit to my friend John at NSXplore on Instagram if you follow him. Kind of another pro-level NSX road trip aficionado. But he turned me onto these for one reason. That's because they can be partially disassembled, as opposed to the big A-frame things, which take up a massive amount of room in your trunk and rattle around. These guys, if you pull the pin out, then this post actually just comes out of the base. And so you can store that separately or be able to tuck it in various different nooks and crannies of the car after you've packed everything else. But when you assemble it, you know, there's a little screw hole in the bottom that affixes it to the base. When you assemble it and set a car down on it, or if you needed to change a tire and use your scissor jack, you would at least have an extra layer of safety here with a legitimate jack stand versus just relying on the kind of infamously unreliable scissor jacks to hold the car up, especially on an uneven surface of any kind, you know, gravel off the hard shoulder or something like that. But that is the odds and ends. Let's now move on to the next category. The next package we have on the table is what I just call my general roadside kit. Not much of this is going to need any explanation, but I'll quickly go over it anyway. This is what's kind of in the car no matter how far I'm driving it, either just to the grocery store across town or to a track across country. And we have, in no particular order here, some jumper cables over there, a set of sturdy-ish gloves, in case I have to deal with anything kind of hot. They have at least a little bit of insulative quality to them. Extra set of spark plugs, just because. Some tubing that comes in handy for bleeding brakes or other hydraulic or liquid, dealing with other liquid stuff. Mirror on a stick for quick inspections. Nitrile gloves in case I have to deal with any kind of brake fluid or something else nasty like that. Ubiquitous duct tape. A couple of different types of rag. Got a rag and a microfiber. I have some can of slime. Which is one of the better reviewed, I think, third-party reviewed tire repair in a can items there. I don't carry my spare with me anymore in the car, the Space Saver spare that came with the NSX. In my case, I A, run aftermarket wheels, so I'm not sure that I could get the diameters to line up, and B, it was aged well beyond any semblance of still being safe to use. So it's not in the car. Instead, I've got some slime if I have to deal with it, and then, of course, my AAA card if I can't. I have invisible glass to clean the windshield. If, you know, that's for good old love bug season in Florida. I've got a flashlight and a little bag with some WD-40 and anti-seize in it. And then, of course, a tire inflator. Next up, we have the toolbox. I'm going to cover this in three different segments. The first is going to be the box itself, kind of specific to the NSX. The second is going to be the specialty tools and other weird stuff that I bring with me in the toolbox. And then the third part will be the specific assortment of more or less regular tools that I carry that's going to be kind of tailored to the NSX itself. Starting out, I guess it's the box itself is worth mentioning for the NSX community. If you are like me and you do not carry your Space Saver spare with you in what would be the frunk, if you also remove the cradle for that, this Cobalt brand toolbox will fit perfectly between your normal, like the OEM battery tray and full-size battery, and the front, the back of the radiator fan. And thus far on a road trip, and I've driven in that configuration, to Palm Springs, California, in 115 degree weather, and have not had any issue, you know, driving on normal road driving. I've never had any thermal issue come up on account of that. So it does not seem to obstruct things. Obviously, if you have any of the, you know, NSX Type R hood or scoop arrangement up there, that's going to preclude being able to use that for storage. But if you have a relatively stock NSX with no spare, if you remove the cradle, this will fit. So moving on to these specialty tools though, yes, I do carry a gear puller with me everywhere I go to the track. It's come in handy. I figured if for things that are stuck, actually probably the place I would most commonly see that used would be the crank pulley. If I had a delamination on the road, I could at least remove the rubber puck from the back of the crank pulley and then continue on my way until I could find a suitable replacement. I also have a ball joint popper that is not a pickle fork, so this is the proper tool to use to pop a ball joint on an NSX in case I needed to do something there. And I have my brake pad adjuster thingy for the front calipers there. And then I have the cube, ubiquitous cube. I'll show you what this thing a little bit closer. You can focus. You put a ratchet extension in any of these square holes, and then you put, I think the easiest one I found on the NSX, which side is it on? Each of these little dimples or these pegs will go into the cross that is cut into your rear caliper, again, stock brakes here, rear caliper parking brake screw piston thingy. So you can use this to screw it back in using a ratchet rather than having to use something like pliers wrenching it around or some junk like that. All right, back to the table. We got a set of tweezers useful for fishing things out. I also have a pair of, I think, forceps or hemostats. I don't know. They're kind of, I've been told one is the other, but the other is not always the one. So anyway, these are clamping surgical plier thingies. They are great for, again, fishing things out of tight places. They are also extremely useful as impromptu hose clamps. If you need to pinch off a coolant hose, coolant bypass hose or something like that, to keep it from leaking while you do some other kind of work, they're amazing for that as well. I got a hockey puck for the jack. Moving back kind of up the table here, this and this are kind of the same thing. This is the 36 millimeter heavy duty impact socket for the axle nuts. This guy is the crank pulley holder. I can use a jack handle on the end of this if I needed to remove my crank pulley in a pinch and brace that against the ground of the frame. Then I have the spanner wrench for the KW coilovers. And this should actually go back in my roadside box, but it's a collapsible wheel chock that I pulled out of a Nissan in a junkyard once. Moving forward, we got some spare hardware, more spare hardware here. I've got another axle nut. I've got a gnarly looking castle nut, but if I was missing a castle nut, it would do in a pinch. I have a brake slider bolt. The last time I had, this is kind of lessons learned here a little bit, at least with these two. The last time that I actually had to have, I think it was NS Expo 2018, and one of our wonderful fellow members run me to a hardware store because I had lost a caliper pin somewhere on the California roads. And kind of noticed it because the brake would clunk as I rolled backwards, and as I rolled forward, it would do something else. And I got to looking at it, and indeed one of these things had made a bid for freedom. Fortunately, the rest of the hardware was still in place, so I just had to replace this one, one of these. But I have this and the associated bolt and washer with it, as well as some other smaller bolts and screws and nuts in that bag there. I have some rubber caps, line caps. So if I had to, cap off a vacuum line to test something, or needed a kind of in a pinch a dust cap for a bleeder screw, I could use one of those. Speaking of bleeding things and dealing with hydraulics, I then have a set of spare bleeder screws as well as various hydraulic adapters and nozzles and rubber plugs for things up here. Hopefully deal with any leaks, or in the weird event that you broke a bleeder screw on something, if you could extract it, then I would have a spare. And then an assortment of hose clamps and a turkey baster. The amount of times that I've been able to deal with either a hydraulic system problem or a coolant system problem by being able to kind of empty out a master cylinder or transfer sort of no spill transfer coolant around with this thing. It's probably happened more times than I would care to admit. So it has bailed me out a few times. So that's all the special thief tools I take. Let me clear this and we will come back with more of the regular fare for you. All right, so on to the regular tool assortment. Now, some of this is pretty specific to the NSX because I am getting down to like the wrench sizes that you'll probably want here. But a lot of this will be kind of standard issue and some of it has some interesting reasoning behind it. So we'll get into that. But without further ado, we'll kind of start at the top, if you will. We have a breaker bar up here. We have a large ratchet, a small ratchet. We have a plastic and rubber hammer mallet right there, and a magnet, extendable magnet right here. Assorted pliers and wire cutters. Down here we have a paint scraper, which is really just a prying implement, another giant prying implement disguised as a screwdriver, and then assorted long and short, or assorted lengths of both Phillips and flat screwdrivers. Moving to the wrenches, we're going to get into some specific sizes here. We start with a 22 millimeter. Now that is kind of specific in that that's what's necessary. If I remember correctly, that's what's necessary to adjust your toe link. So if you needed to align your car in a pinch, you would need a 22 millimeter and a 19, and I believe a 19 millimeter to accomplish that. So that's what we have at the top there, a 22 millimeter, 19 millimeter. 19 is also used for some other large suspension bolts. Then we have a 17, a ratcheting 17, because changing the settings on your sway bar end links without a ratcheting 17 millimeter wrench is a huge waste of time. We have got 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, and 10, with at the bottom there a 10 and 12 millimeter flare nut wrench in case I need to deal with any hydraulic lines that I can't get a box wrench all the way around, I can't get a box wrench on, and the open end of the crescent wrench would be likely to strip it, in my opinion. So flare nut wrench does help with that. At least gives you a little bit better chance. Flare nut crow's foot would be ideal there. I don't have those generally in my track box though. If I'm having to deal with a hydraulic issue that's that bad, or I'm having to undo lines, I'm probably done for the day anyway. But similar sizes of both short and deep well socket sets, various extensions and adapters, including a swivel. I also have kind of parsed out here. This is an 8 millimeter deep well with its own little adapter there, and that would specifically be if I ever had to take the tail lights out. There may be some other 8 millimeter screws in the car. There aren't very many, but you know, had to deal with some random electrical problem and get the tail lights out, you would need one of those. So. The last thing here is this one more screw, and this is not a screw that goes on any component of the car, but it is a screw, a throwaway screw, specifically designed or specifically sized to go into the brake caliper. So if your brake, into your brake rotor. If your brake rotor is stuck on your car, if you had to change your rotor for some reason or gets to something behind the rotor, and the rotor will not come off with normal pulling or other persuasion. Usually at the track it's not a problem, it gets hot, and worst case you need a tap from a hammer to knock it loose, or a mallet rather, to knock it loose. But in case it's more stuck than that, you can thread this into a couple of holes on the face of the rotor and it will push against the hub and pop the rotor off pretty reliably. You do have to put some measurable torque on it though. So as I said, this is a throwaway screw. I have to replace it every once in a while because the threads will get all mangled on the end there from having to put a lot of torque on it to pop the rotor off. But that is the regular tool assortment. I'm critiquing myself here. Oh, and I had some metric Allen wrenches over there and some zip ties. I think it was the only things I didn't mention. And then an additional mirror on a stick. Now, I'm probably overkill. If I was going pure minimalist, I could get away with fewer wrenches and maybe fewer sockets. If your NSX is completely stock, if you have all of the original nuts and bolts on there and you're pretty confident of that, you don't need the 11, 13, or 15 millimeter anything. I have found a couple of screws or components, or I've replaced a couple of screws or components with odd sizes just over the years. In most cases, I've gone back and fixed them, but I added these things to the toolkit when I did those things and I haven't undone it. And then I don't want to go back and try and take inventory of every nut or bolt on the car. So they all fit in the box. It is what it is. Moving on. The last box of stuff we're going to talk about anyway is my electronics slash electrical box here. The box, again, worth mentioning, that is, I think, a tackle box of some kind, but it's gasketed, so it's waterproof. Kind of important if you're having expensive electronics in it, and it's going to be out in the weather potentially. But starting from left to right, we have a pyrometer. Now, that's one I've debated taking out, because a pyrometer, it's used to take your tire temperatures across the cross-section of the tread. Usually that's done in the process of dialing in your setup. Now, I haven't changed my setup with respect to tire sizes or suspension alignment in a long time, so I'm probably not at the point of needing that anymore, except just to check on things periodically. But the Falcon tires I've been using have worn very evenly between the road trips and track days that I've been doing, so that tells me that things are largely probably where they should be, if not completely optimized for one use or the other. So next we have a laser thermometer. I've used that to check brake temperatures occasionally. We have a bag of assorted fuses, a couple of spare relays. I think these could work on several different systems as far as the relays and the NSX go anyway. I got a set of long test leads, some short test leads, your sort of do-it-all wiring plier, wire cutter thingies, and a bore scope. Now, this could be useful. Again, this is kind of the, camera on a cord that at one point in time I was able to actually use this on my phone, but I think with the latest Android updates, it no longer, there's some rigmarole that I haven't figured out to get this to work with the latest Android version. But if you have an iPhone, or if you just carry a laptop around like I sometimes do, then this you can just plug that straight into a USB and run it from that. And then the last thing, of course, you see up here in the box itself is the ubiquitous spare main relay. I think that is something common. If you drive a Honda or have driven a Honda product for a long time, you're probably chuckling. 90s Honda products are kind of notorious for the main relays, leaving you stranded, and the NSX is unfortunately no exception to that. So most folks I know that drive them long distances carry a spare with them just in their glove box. In my case, I carry them in my electronics box with a little extra protection of being in a weatherproof container. But with that said, we're going to talk about one more thing here before we wrap up, and that is the car itself. I wanted to take a moment and kind of address how I outfit my car, or rather how I don't outfit my car to do any of these long trips. I've kind of, for various reasons, decided against trying to do something like taking the ski box route, or even the route of making a trailer out of a half of a destroyed NSX in order to do what I do. Nothing but love, Chris, but I have yet to find any of those measures necessary, although I will point out that everyone's kind of personal needs and logistics will be different, so it is kind of fun to see how the other solutions that people come up with to get what they need in the car for the trip that they are individually doing. Be that something as simple as making the frunk into a functional trunk to aforementioned half-cut NSX trailer and tent on the roof. In my case, though, my wife and I have managed to do, I think our record thus far is NS Expo 2018, where we did the run from East Tennessee to Central California to Thunder Hill Raceway and then San Francisco for the social portion of that event. That was a 40-hour one-direction drive for us, if you count our sort of meandering pace and touristing around a little bit. Neither my wife nor I are any sort of card-carrying members of that fraternity of lunatics who have, I think, just reset the New York to LA record at 25 hours and 30-something minutes. grats to Arnie Duggan and company there. But, we don't do that kind of road trip, but we have nonetheless. It means it takes longer and you need more stuff because you're staying more nights in between being able to kind of, do laundry or anything like that. But, utilizing most nooks and crannies, of the NSX, we have managed to do that trip at least in relative comfort and not end up wanting for anything. So, until I have a burning need to make any kind of modification or extra appendage on the car, I'm not going to. So that's just kind of wanted to touch on that quick point, since that's been kind of a popular thing lately on the internet, but as I said, I'm completely entertained watching the people that have done stuff like that. It's, part of my reasoning is that once I get to a track somewhere, even if I could, you know, for instance, open the engine hatch and get to the mechanicals with a roof box in place, I would then have to remove the roof box in order to drive on the track, due to most requirements and good sensibilities, even though I know those Seasucker cups will hold pretty sturdily at any speed that this car could get up to on a track in North America. But, and that's a two-person job, so then you've got to kind of, you know, beg, borrow, and steal once you get to the track and hope you don't, nick anything on the car, et cetera, et cetera. And it's just more of a headache than I'm willing to deal with right now, considering how I operate and the lack of challenge that I've run into in the packing space. And this car actually is better than it was because I've redone the carpet flocking whatever on the on the inner engine cover, so I could actually use that as a non-thermally sensitive storage space if I needed to in a pinch. But that's too much on this section already, so we will go ahead and move on. So that, along with the usual personal effects and pile of camera equipment in my case, that is what I'll be taking with me this coming weekend up to Dakota County Technical College, just south of Minneapolis. That's a 15-hour run from Knoxville, Tennessee, up to that area. So, fingers crossed everything goes well and I make it safely. But again, hopefully I am prepared for at least minor inconveniences, if not more than that. But again, with fingers crossed and wood knocked upon, I will be seeing you guys next from the track, I believe. So until then, I hope you found this informative, if not entertaining. And as always, I will see you guys in the next video, if not at the track.